Hi, I'm Mike Gilliam, and welcome to a CUNY TV virtual town hall, 9/11, 20 years later. The devastating attacks on the World Trade Center towers and the Pentagon happened 20 years ago today. The scale and the magnitude of the destruction will, of course, never be forgotten. Nearly 3,000 people were killed that day, and the city and national psyche forever scarred. The short-term responses were swift. By October 2001, the U.S. had gone to war in Afghanistan. Locally, the economy was hit hard, with thousands of jobs lost while billions of dollars evaporated. In 2002, the U.S. created the Department of Homeland Security and passed the USA Patriot Act. In 2003, the U.S. went to war against Iraq. The next year, the 9/11 Commission report was released, and it exposed the security and intelligence failures that allowed the attacks to happen. But looking back from today, what are the long-term impacts of the 9/11 attacks? Has the counterterrorism effort been successful, both in the city and nationally? What about the impact on our collective psychology? How can we trace the politics from that day to today? And how does the war against the Taliban in Afghanistan, a 20-year conflict that just recently ended, fit into the narrative? Joining me to discuss these issues are Peter Romaniuk, director of the Center of Terrorism at John Jay College of Criminal Justice, Susan Opotow, a professor at John Jay College of Criminal Justice and the Graduate Center and co-editor of the book, New York After 9/11, and Daniel Disalvo, a professor and chair of political science at the Colin Powell School at City College. Welcome to all of you. So 20 years ago, we started a conflict in Afghanistan, which just ended in a very difficult way. Peter, can you trace the line from 9/11 to today in terms of our counterterrorism operations? Did America succeed in any way in rooting out terrorism in the Far East?
I think the sort of singular success of the post 9/11 period has been that there has not been another 9/11. If our objective when we woke up on the 12th of September in 2001 was to prevent another event like 9/11, then indeed we have succeeded in that regard. However, if we take a global perspective and we look regionally in the Middle East and South Asia, or indeed if we look in other parts of the world, especially in sub-Saharan Africa and the Horn, we see that actually, you know, the extremist threat today is quite diverse, extremely complex, extremely challenging. And we also see sort of forms of extremism emerge domestically that we perhaps have not paid enough attention to in the post 9/11 years. So in this regard, I think it's safe to say that the record of counterterrorism in the last 20 years has been decidedly mixed.
Well, much has been made about us being less safe after the pullout from Afghanistan. Do you believe that to be the case?
So the answer to that question really turns on whether Afghanistan will lapse to become something like it was before 9/11, which is to say a safe haven for extremists that are capable of operating on a global scale. Evidence suggests that it's hard to form a conclusion about that. There are some incentives that the Taliban have, for example, to try to get along better with the international community, to be a bit more rigorous in terms of not allowing Afghan territory to be used to plan attacks in the region and globally. For my part, I think that we are entering a period of real uncertainty and real instability. The rapid nature of the withdrawal from Afghanistan leaves a lot of questions unanswered. The nature of Taliban rule, the willingness of the Taliban to allow extremists from elsewhere to occupy Afghan territory, to utilize that territory to build their capacity to advance an extremist cause on a regional or a global scale. I fear the worst in the coming years.
Daniel, as we talk about New York City specifically, President Bush made an iconic speech standing atop the ruins of the World Trade Center. At that time, it seemed revenge was on everyone's mind, but there was a city left reeling. We were slammed economically by the 9/11 attacks. How did New York survive economically?
New York survived in some ways because it had so many advantages. It's one of the, you know, history's great cities. It's the financial capital of the largest economy in the world. So in that sense, it had a lot going for it economically. you know, a lot of what we consider Wall Street quickly decamped to Midtown, and that's where much of the financial sector now bases its offices, not in lower Manhattan on Wall Street anymore. You could say it recovered economically from savvy leadership in the financial sector, from Mayor Bloomberg in particular. So in that respect, the city was able to recover quickly. Politically, in some ways, that was partly luck. You could say that Mayor Bloomberg probably would not have been elected without 9/11 and without the leadership of who was then considered America's mayor, Rudy Giuliani, who achieved a kind of heroic profile. And it's very likely that otherwise, in the mayoral election that occurred nearly right after the events of 9/11, the city would have defaulted to its more traditional Democratic Party dominance. And then Bloomberg, running again as a Republican at that time, would not have won. So in a way, politics and economics were intertwined and provided for a revival of the city. Now, that revival is not without its blemishes and aspects which people don't like. The inequality, income inequality surged under Bloomberg. Certain parts of the city were perhaps favored over others. So it's not like any legacy, political and economic legacy, it's not unblemished.
Do you think that Bloomberg delivered?
Certainly crime remained low under Bloomberg. That, as we've learned in recent months, as crime has crept back up in the city, how damaging that can be to civic life. Certainly the financial sector under Bloomberg did heroically well. So that those could be areas of success. And one can think of many other civic projects, the completion of the 7th Avenue subway line that came to fruition under Bloomberg after long delay. One also might even mention, importantly, the construction of a rebuilding of not the towers themselves, but of the World Plaza downtown and the 9/11 Memorial, which took a very long time, 10 years after 9/11. There was still very little construction in lower Manhattan where the towers had stood. But today we have a bit tall and beautiful building there and a 9/11 memorial. And that was all completed under Mayor Bloomberg.
Mm-hmm. Susan, how important was that rebuild to our collective psyche?
I think that the rebuilding of Ground Zero is critically important because it almost seemed like a physical manifestation of the entire city's recovery, to recover our identity, to recover our sense of well-being.
Peter, I want to go back to a little bit of the law enforcement angle on all of this. Following 9/11, the NYPD was very active, and some have said they basically became like a federal police force working to stamp out terrorism and going around the world to do that. With what has happened in Afghanistan, what do you expect the role of the NYPD to be now? I know that there was some criticism as to their surveillance of Muslims and that sort of thing before. What do you expect now?
You're absolutely correct about that. I mean, the NYPD invested heavily in its counterterrorism capacity in the wake of the 9/11 attacks. It should be noted that they had done so in a way that was quite remarkable for a municipal police force in the pre-9/11 period, not least in response to the 1993 World Trade Center attack. And the NYPD over the years had developed the capacity to station officers abroad to develop its own collaborative and cooperative relationships with other municipal police forces or other law enforcement agencies in key foreign countries and so on. It's certainly the case that the NYPD follows the arc of counterterrorism missteps in the post 9/11 period. We did have a very sort of assertive policing approach to counterterrorism. A lot was invested in community level measures that get described as surveillance with good reason. Plenty has been written about this and the way in which local minority communities, especially Muslim communities, felt as though they were being spied upon and surveilled. I do think that had some unintended consequences, some negative consequences in terms of undermining police community relations in a way that is contrary to the ideals of community policing. I do think, however, that in New York, just as nationally, and indeed I would even say internationally, lessons have been learned regarding how to formulate and implement counterterrorism policies in the post 9/11 period. We've seen a sort of a broad trend from an overemphasis on what we might describe as hard power or kinetic tools, the use of the military and law enforcement domestically, for example, to more sort of soft power approaches, community engagement, efforts to act preventively, efforts to counter extremist ideas, and so on. And I think that what we can expect in the future, again, both here in New York and nationally and again globally, is that this sort of recalibration of counterterrorism will continue. I think governments, if they've acted smartly, if they've learned those lessons, have realized that sometimes counterterrorism can be counterproductive. Sometimes it's part of the problem and not part of the solution. Unfortunately, there are examples of that in the post 9/11 period. And if governments are prudent, what we'll see going forward is a more measured approach that's more sustainable, more effective, and that respects basic democratic rights.
It seemed to me during that time that some of the things that the NYPD was doing were helpful mentally, psychologically. And Susan, I want to ask you about this. It's like we have the shows of force where we'd have like maybe 25 NYPD cars riding around showing that they could rapidly respond. We had people with long arms out on Times Square. While they were not taking down terrorists, wasn't that helpful though for us to see that?
Well, my lens on this is not, and I don't have data to answer specifically whether or not that was helpful to give people a sense that the NYPD was there for them and to protect them. But I am much more familiar with what happened to the Muslim community as a result of the overreach and the surveillance. A lot of their attention was on infiltrating student groups, and this affected CUNY students disproportionately. The students became extremely, it had a chilling effect on their education, on their affiliations with groups and with others. They never knew who was a spy. People that they had befriended and vice versa turned out to be undercover. And it affected every aspect of their lives, who they could talk to, where they worshiped, what they studied, what they said in class, their group meetings. They didn't have the potential to meet as the Muslim community as students because it was constantly infiltrated. And so I see that generation as having been scarred by that. And that's really a tragedy when a whole group of students who are, you know, young people coming up, you know, learning, or, have undermined trust in the government and in their own privacy and in the government's protection of their rights.
Daniel, let's turn to politics now. I'd like to know what you think about how our politics have been formed and changed both back right after 9/11 and now.
Yeah, what's interesting here, Mike, I think, is that first, there was this huge surge of patriotism and, in a sense, a kind of national consensus, a rally around the flag effect. President Bush's popularity numbers went up very high. But that very quickly dissipated, as, in a sense, the event of 9/11 itself and the attacks were quickly subsumed by our partisan politics, meaning people viewed everything, in a sense, through the lens of the rivalries in Washington between Republicans and Democrats. And we can see that in the shifting character of the arguments and debates over the policies pursued at every level of government since 9/11. So many of, for example, President Bush's loudest critics quickly went silent when President Obama was elected and continued or pursued or even expanded some of the same policies. Then as we've shifted back and forth between Republicans and Democrats, you can see that there's been a great deal of opportunism as each party has tried to leverage whatever twist or turn of events, whether in Afghanistan, Iraq, or in the broader war on terror, for their own domestic political advantage. And in that sense, you could say that there's no consensus on what the meaning of 9/11 is or how it should actually be remembered. Because it's been subsumed entirely in domestic partisan warfare. So we look back and we say, do we even really want to remember? There's not a clear case. You could look at, analogize this in some ways to Pearl Harbor. You look back at Pearl Harbor, there's a kind of national consensus on the meaning of Pearl Harbor. But I say for 9/11, there's no such consensus, in part because our politics domestically sort of overtook the event rather than the event changing our politics.
Mm, interesting.
Yeah. What do you think about the whole thing that you mentioned earlier about people being very patriotic and the flag, now that we have a situation where it almost appears as though one political faction is wrapped in the flag and using the flag, but almost weaponizing it? Do you think we can ever really get back to that feeling of camaraderie that we had after 9/11?
Well, I would say very unlikely in the current political moment, barring another attack of a similar magnitude that would create perhaps momentarily some sort of consensus. Otherwise, partisan polarization and especially negative partisanship, people really disliking the other party of which they're not a member, is simply too strong. Now, when it comes to one party wrapping themselves in the flag and the others, that's a hard matter to sort out. If you look across American political history, one party has always been a little bit more, let's say, the patriotic party or the pro-nation state party, and the other party's been a little bit more skeptical about such sentiments. So that's probably a sort of basic feature of American political life. Now, I think more troublingly is the number of people in various surveys going back to, say, 2006 or so, who believed that the American government in general, or perhaps the Bush administration in particular, were complicit in the 9/11 attacks, either directly facilitating them or at least allowing them to happen. And this kind of conspiratorial mindset, which some surveys indicate is these views are held by as much as 20 and perhaps as much as 36% of the public. And this is what I think goes back to what's partly connected to our deep partisan divisions, and is that the event is so wrapped up in the character of the nation state. And there's been a really critical attitude toward the American nation state, right? And a real skepticism about whether the United States is a force for good. And in fact, if it isn't, perhaps it's complicit in creating all of these bad things that happen in the world. And I think that mindset, this highly critical attitude, skepticism of all kinds of government authority, and seeing any form of government authority as wrapped up in some sort of broader cabal. And that's troubling. And obviously that makes any kind of consensus along the lines that you suggest nearly impossible to achieve.
We're on the 20th anniversary of the 9/11 attacks. How do we best process that, Susan? I mean, it's a difficult thing to actually deal with. How do we put it all into perspective and deal with it?
In the book, there's a comparative paper on the processing of Hiroshima after the 1945 atomic bombing and comparing that with what happened in terms of the community engagement after 9/11. And it's a kind of talks about how much time it takes to work through this trauma, how we experienced it. You know, every generation now we have one generation. Some people who are now 20 have no personal experience with this. And then we have the mid-generation that, you know, who 20s to 40s. And then we have people who are older who've experienced other major disasters. And so their perspectives are very different. So the understanding, I think, in the city is very layered according to age and also according to the well-being of the community that people are part of. During the aftermath of 9/11, some sectors of the society did very well. Others did very poorly. Chinatown in particular was particularly hard hit in terms of everything that they do. Garment, restaurants, all the work that they did was, you know, low paid work, and they did not do well. Taxi drivers did poorly. There were, you know, so we have to think about, I think, the periods from 9/11 till now in a very layered way, a very nuanced way in terms of where people are now in their lifespan, where they are in terms of their well-being. I think, though, that we do come together on some issues, and I think that the ambivalence that you've described, Daniel, is really very helpful, because that is really how I think, you know, there's just a lot of everyone's experience is somewhat different. People also have their own personal experiences of the process of recovery. 9/11 will remain with us for a time. And I think the 20th anniversary is a time to take stock because it's still in living memory of many people. And I think it's this show now and the other commemorations that are taking place throughout the city and throughout CUNY are a really important opportunity to work things through together, not just individually, that we can discuss it together and we can see different points of view and learn things we never knew about the past so that we can move forward more or less together. I mean, the fact that we'll ever be united and all see it the same way, I don't think is a goal that will actually be achieved, nor is it necessarily a positive goal. I think the diversity of views is very important in a democratic society, that we all bring our own perspectives and our own life experiences to the process of recovery.
It's certainly important in New York. Peter, what's going to have to happen from a law enforcement, counterterrorism perspective to keep us safe going forward?
I think it's important that we learn the lessons and integrate the lessons of the last 20 years. I certainly agree with Susan about the importance of conversations like this one. I think it's vital that we're frank, and I've heard some good commentaries that have been very, very critical, identifying and calling attention to our missteps and trying to reorient the way we go about suppressing extremism and acting against terrorist threats. You know, one thing that really strikes me about going forward, though, is our ability to integrate these lessons. The points that Daniel made earlier about the level of partisanship, the level of division domestically in the United States at the moment, these are really, really telling. Insofar as we've had counterterrorism successes, it's worked because there's been a political consensus about what the threat is and how to respond to it. And it's really, I think, something that we should all pause and think about to contrast the post 9/11 commission experience, which obviously developed this, I think, quite robust evidence-based document that was able to sort of prompt a series of prudent policy changes. And then look at what's happened just this year with regard to the argument in Washington about creating an analogous commission to look at 1/6, right? You know, it's very, very sobering that on the 20th anniversary of 9/11, just as we're pulling out of Afghanistan, we're more politically divided than ever. We have a range of extremist threats that are domestic, that are transnational, and that our capacity to deal with them, our capacity to generate enough political consensus to deal with them in a sensible way, is really quite modest.
Okay. And Daniel, politically, what has to happen here to make sure that these things don't happen again and that we come together a bit?
Well, I would say very unlikely in the current political moment, barring another attack of a similar magnitude that would create perhaps momentarily some sort of consensus. Otherwise, partisan polarization and especially negative partisanship, people really disliking the other party of which they're not a member, is simply too strong. Now, when it comes to one party wrapping themselves in the flag and the others, that's a hard matter to sort out. If you look across American political history, one party has always been a little bit more, let's say, the patriotic party or the pro-nation state party, and the other party's been a little bit more skeptical about such sentiments. So that's probably a sort of basic feature of American political life. Now, I think more troublingly is the number of people in various surveys going back to, say, 2006 or so, who believed that the American government in general, or perhaps the Bush administration in particular, were complicit in the 9/11 attacks, either directly facilitating them or at least allowing them to happen. And this kind of conspiratorial mindset, which some surveys indicate is these views are held by as much as 20 and perhaps as much as 36% of the public. And this is what I think goes back to what's partly connected to our deep partisan divisions, and is that the event is so wrapped up in the character of the nation state. And there's been a really critical attitude toward the American nation state, right? And a real skepticism about whether the United States is a force for good. And in fact, if it isn't, perhaps it's complicit in creating all of these bad things that happen in the world. And I think 20 years, and in effect, nothing was achieved besides enriching Northern Virginia contractors and some Afghani warlords, democracy building, state building, building an army in Afghanistan, was a complete failure. And again, that had support from, you could say, both liberal foreign policy types on the left and in the Democratic Party establishment and neoconservatives on the right in the Republican foreign policy establishment. So again, events have conspired in some ways to lend credence to some of the worst instincts, one might say, currently circulating in parts of public opinion.
A good discussion as we all take time to remember what happened 20 years ago today and the lives lost. That day changed all of our lives forever, and we will always remember. I want to thank our guest, Peter Romaniuk, Director of the Center for Terrorism at John Jay College of Criminal Justice, Susan Opotow, a professor at the City University of New York, and Daniel Disalvo, a professor and chair of political science at the Colin Powell School of Civic and Global Leadership. Thank you all. I'm Mike Gilliam. Thank you for joining us for this CUNY TV virtual town hall marking the 20th anniversary of the terror attacks, 9/11, 20 years later. Good night.